Welcome to worship with Plymouth Park United Methodist Church. My name is Marcus Womack, pastor here. We're so glad that you have joined us for worship this day. Wherever you're gathered, we invite you to light a candle in your home and with whoever's with you. We are gathered around the light of Christ every week, and we are reminded that no matter where we gather, the Spirit of God is what connects us and keeps us bonded as church family. As you're worshiping, we hope you'll let us know that you're here today. Leave a comment on Facebook, or if you're watching through our website, please send an email or connect with the church office. We want to know how we can be supporting you as your church family during this time, and we want to see all the ways we are still so vitally connected. In the coming weeks of our church, there'll be ways to embrace that connection. On Saturday, October 31st, on Halloween, we are planning a drive-through trunk-or-treat experience, and we hope that it's a safe way for our families and children and neighborhood around us to connect in a fun way during the season. It will be safe. We ask that kids are going to stay in their cars and that anyone helping with trunks around our parking lot would be wearing masks, but we hope that you will participate in that. We'd love to have about 20 cars as part of that, as we have that drive-through experience. And you can talk to Krista Bailey, our children's minister, if you'd like to participate or if you have questions. Also, coming up on next Sunday will be All Saints. We will have our online service where we'll have remembrances of those from our church family who have died in the past year. If there is someone in your life or in our church family that we would like to remember, please contact the church office to let us know. As part of that, we will have the online service with that remembrance, but we will also gather in the parking lot on Sunday, November 1st for an outdoor bring your own communion service. So bring your elements, but also we will share in Holy Communion and share in the remembrance of the saints as well. Be on the lookout for your all church email for other upcoming events in the month of November and as we continue this month in October. Today we finish our worship series, Family Values, as we hear the conclusion of Moses' journey with the people of Israel and find what we value in the midst of that continuation of the story. Now will you join in preparing our hearts, minds, and lives for worshiping the living God together this day.
Good morning. I'm Reverend Audra Welch Malvez, pastor here at Plymouth Park. Thanks for joining us for worship this morning. We begin worship with a call to worship. So wherever you are, will you join us now? God of our ancestors made a promise long ago. God's steadfast love endures forever. God is made known to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. God's steadfast love endures forever. God continues to be revealed through the Holy Spirit. God's steadfast love endures forever. Come, may we worship God who was and who is to come. Almighty God's steadfast love endures forever. To our time of prayer this morning, we extend our sympathy to Virginia Mueller and family on the death of her husband, Jim. And we also extend our sympathy to Charles and Karen Perry and their family on the death of their son, Christopher. We keep in our prayers this week those in need of health and healing from our church family, including Marilyn Rogers, who is Tony Lampe's sister, and Andy Schellenberg, who worships with us. We also have our ongoing concerns that have been sent out in our church communications email. We know that God hears these prayers. We know that God sees their faces, that God holds them tenderly just as we do. We lift them all before God, along with the cares of our world, with the things that are looming in front of us. We lift them before God. We say, Lord, in your mercy, I invite you to respond. Hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayer. Now, when we go into our prayer today, this is a a group activity when we pray. This isn't, these are words that I pray on our behalf, that together we bring them before God. But this is also your time to be in God's presence as you need to be in this dedicated, set-aside moment of prayer. So I want to give you a moment of silence to be in God's presence how you need to, whether it's rejoicing or if it is simply listening for the still, small voice of God. Let us pray. God of love and mercy, we are tired. The exhaustion is seeping into our bones and our buckets are scraping the bottom of our wells of patience. Remember your people, O God, as we stumble through the uncertainty. God, we look to you to bring an end to evil, and to save us from our enemies. Renew our faith in this time, O God, that we would put ourselves in your hands, that whatever happens, the good and the bad, God, we look to you to help, and we trust that you will be with us, that somehow you will make a way. Holy Spirit, guide our feet as we walk the path of discipleship. By your grace, transform us into the likeness in which you created us. Conform us into the image of Christ. Clothe us in your humility. Give us eyes to see others better than we see ourselves. That like Jesus, we might take the status of servant in all areas of our lives. And may we do it all for the sake of making your love known, of creating family and a space of belonging for the people that we know and love and the people that we haven't met yet. God, keep our eyes locked and focused on you. You are the wellspring of life. You are the giver of good things. You are the ruler of all. On your strong shoulders, we place the heavy things that we carry, that we name in our hearts before you now. And God, we join you in the dance of celebration for the good things that you have given us, that we name before you now. And Lord, we ask that you would tend the sick, bless the dying, soothe the suffering, pity the afflicted, shield the joyous. Remind us each day that our common life depends on one another. We join our voices together with the confidence of the children of God to pray the words that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hey friends, I'm Jack.
And I'm Krista.
And if you have been following along with us for the past several months, you have found out that God is everywhere.
He is.
God is in the backyard, the bedroom, the house, everywhere that you look, God is there. And the way that we have found this out is we pull a name out of a traffic cone every single week, and that name is responsible for sending us a picture of something in their house. And then we take that item and we relate it to God, Jesus, and the Bible.
That's right. And we've had some really great items so far. So let's do a quick recap.
All
are
right,
you ready?
Let's do it.
Here we go. We had Sebastian in his bike helmet, Harvick in his guitar, Bryce in his colored pencils, Pierce in his fishing pole, Elijah and the Legos. We had Leland and Larkin with the kitty cat and the imagination suit. We had Keegan with the trampoline, Alice and her baby doll, Brooke and her teddy bear, Gabriella and Baking Barbie, Graham and her beautiful star, Grayson and her music box. It was fantastic. And then we had Ryan with the Incredible Hulk. Yeah. So it's been awesome. So we have Anthony Molina. Let's see what he sent us. Are you ready? Okay.
What is it going to be?
I know. Are you ready? I'm nervous. Anthony is all decked out in his baseball catcher's uniform. This is serious. Okay. Look at that.
And I think if I recall, he's pretty good at baseball.
I think so too.
So that's pretty cool to see him all decked out. And when I see this, it reminds me of a scripture in Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, which we find in the New Testament.
That's right.
And it talks about the armor of God.
It does. And you know what? I think I have a Bible right here. Ephesians says, "So put on all of God's armor. Evil days will come, but you will be able to stand up to anything. And after you have done everything you can, you will still be standing. So stand firm. Put the belt of truth around your waist. Put the armor of godliness on your chest. Wear on your feet what will prepare you to tell the good news of peace. Also, pick up the shield of faith. And with it, you can put out all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Put on the helmet of salvation. And take the sword of the Holy Spirit. The sword is God's word. At all times, pray by the power of the Spirit. Pray all kinds of prayers. Be watchful so that you can pray. Always keep on praying for all of God's people." I think that's pretty awesome, Jack.
Yeah.
And you look pretty amazing in all of that armor of God.
I say.
You do. Rely on the armor of God.
That's right.
Put it on every day, kids. Anthony, thanks for such an amazing picture. Can't wait to come see you play ball.
Good job. Yeah.
All right, well, let's draw another name, Jack.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Let's see who it is.
Okay, mix it up.
Is it going to be?
Turn it around. Okay, I feel one.
Who is it
gonna be? Waylon! Okay, Waylon, send us something amazing. I know you will. All right.
Let's see it. All right, friends, let's pray. Oh God, we are grateful for you and all the ways that you work in our lives. God, we thank you for a baseball catcher suit and all the ways that it teaches us about your word and about the armor of God that we find in Ephesians. God, help us this week. Keep us safe, and bring us back next week. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, and sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my life, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. My helpless.
Say each week we are wearing our masks here always as a sign of love and care for one another in this space and for you. We are so blessed to be joined by folks from our church family worshiping with us in our sanctuary as we record the service for the weekend. We are so glad all of you have joined us and know that if wherever you're worshiping, we are more complete because you are here as well. We've been so blessed from the music by the P3 band and Pat Horner leading it as well. Every other Monday, they gather in the fellowship hall, and you're invited the next time they do that in a couple of weeks. What a blessing. And also, we're so blessed by having Diana Schultz here playing piano in duets with our organist, Ken Surley. What a gift to be led in such a beautiful way in our worship tonight. And with Jared Masters, our choral scholar, leading in our hymns, and Dr. Michael Lindstrom leading in our music ministries. And I'm always grateful for our associate pastor, Reverend Audra Welch Malvez, and the prayers that she offers and her pastoral presence that helps keep our church family connected in so many ways. And I think our youth minister, Jack Payne, just got himself a new uniform. So that's exciting. But I'm always grateful for the ways he and Krista connect our families in so many vital ways. Tonight, we have Kathy Bongfeldt is running our media, and Tom Rubeck is editing this service together for us, and we're so grateful for their work. And I'm so grateful for those volunteers who made it possible for folks to worship with us in person. Holly Holloway has done so much work to prepare in that, and Sherry Davis was helping us this evening, and there are so many each week that we've been doing this who have helped, and so I offer my thanks and gratitude for them as well. In our scripture this weekend, we reached the conclusion of a journey we have been on for several months. We started over months ago talking about this story God has been telling from the beginning of all things in creation, and we've continued through how a family is forged through the liberation of the Exodus and what family values come out of that story. Tonight, what we hear from, and this weekend, is from Moses' culmination and the end of his part of that story, and how it will then continue on through the faith beyond him. So we prepare our hearts, minds, and lives for the word of God in scripture from Deuteronomy 34. Then Moses hiked up from the Moabite plains to Mount Nebo, the peak of the Pisgah slope, which faces Jericho. The Lord showed him the whole land, the Gilead region, as far as Dan's territory, all the parts belonging to Naphtali, along with the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, as well as the entirety of Judah, as far as the Mediterranean Sea, also the arid southern plain, and the plain including the Jericho Valley, Palm City, as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to Moses, "This is the land that I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when I promised, I will give it to your descendants. I have shown it to you with your own eyes. However, you will not cross over into it." Then Moses, the Lord's servant, died right there in the land of Moab, according to the Lord's command. The Lord buried him in a valley in Moabite country across from Beth Peor. Even now, no one knows where Moses' grave is. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eyesight wasn't impaired and his vigor hadn't diminished a bit. Back down in the Moabite plains, the Israelites mourned Moses' death for 30 days. At that point, the time for weeping and for mourning Moses was over. Joshua, Nun's son, was filled with wisdom because Moses had placed his hands on him. So the Israelites listened to Joshua, and they did exactly what the Lord commanded Moses. No prophet like Moses has yet emerged in Israel. Moses knew the Lord face to face. That's not even to mention all those signs and wonders that the Lord sent Moses to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh, to all his servants, and to his entire land, as well as the extraordinary power that Moses displayed before Israel's own eyes. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? God of love and God of grace, this is your time and we are your people. Open our hearts, our minds, and our lives to your presence, that we would receive your word and respond with all that we are. Amen. To be Moses in this moment. I would love to have been right beside him, to have asked him so many questions. Maybe first of all, how do you feel right now? He has been at this point leading this people of God from slavery to the promised land, and we can lose count of the hurdles along the way, be it the beginning of the journey and his own self-doubt. He stands in the presence of God at the burning bush with a message directly from God that so many of us long to have that kind of clarity, and says, "Well, I'm not sure I can do it." What about my brother? I'm not a good public speaker. I don't know. Somebody else. And then Pharaoh, as Moses and Aaron again and again go before this mighty ruler and say, "Let God's people go." And over again, Pharaoh says, "Not yet. No. Until God moves with this undeniable presence," as we talked about in the Passover story weeks ago. To then the people of Israel's own doubts, after they have seen miraculous things, the plagues and the liberation, the waters parting that lead them into freedom out of slavery, and they have the audacity to turn to Moses and say, "Can we go back to Egypt? We're not really sure about the road ahead. It seems a little dangerous. It seems a little tricky. We're pretty afraid. We sent spies over into that land that God said we're going to, and it seems pretty bad over there. You were up on that mountain a long time. We got a little scared and unsure, so we made our own idol. Is there going to be enough food? Is there going to be enough water? At least in Egypt, we had 3 square meals a day. At least in Egypt, it was terrible, but we knew what to expect." The devil you know versus the devil you don't. After almost an entire generation, it says 40 years wandering. We hear that Moses was 120 when he breathed his last. So he was a young, strapping 80. Did I get the math right? I'm not good at math. Did I get that mental math right? I studied the Bible, and they didn't have the arithmetic of the Hebrew Bible there for me in divinity school, but here we are. Imagine Moses saying, 40 years to get here, and now I get to see all of the land, but you don't get to go in. I wonder, did he arrive to that point and say, "Come on! Really? We're right there!" Or did he get there, get to see it all, and God says, "Take it all in. This is the land that I promised your people, your ancestors, Abraham and Sarah, Jacob and his children, these people you have journeyed with. Look at it, take it all in." And that's enough. And I wonder if Moses looks at it all and says, "Yeah, that sounds about right." Or perhaps there's peace. For Moses to know, he has already had to lay hands upon Joshua, the son of Nun, who has been a faithful servant and co-leader among God's people. Maybe he has enough trust to say, "This is my part of the journey, my part of the story, and that's enough." I wonder, in any given moment, if it might be any of those emotions. For whatever I might want to have conjecture about how Moses might be feeling, how Moses might be thinking, we know without a doubt this is where his part of the story ends. What I find beautiful in this moment is that the story of God transcends any one person. As holy as they may be, and these final words of the Torah or the Pentateuch, these almost set above books of Scripture for the rest of the Hebrew Bible, they end reminding us how good Moses was. There wasn't a prophet who came who's emerged yet like him. And it gives us those greatest hits one more time, just so we won't forget all of the signs, all of the wonders, all of the things God did through Moses. And yet, God's story transcends even all of those amazing things. the story continues. As we have walked in the wilderness with God's people, we have explored the values of this people, that they had been forged together with a new identity, with a new purpose, renewing their faith in the God of their ancestors. And some of the values we have encountered have been faith in the midst of doubt, a grace and mercy that transcends any of our mistakes, an encounter with the divine that is more substantive and able to sustain so much more deeply than a simple how-to manual or a roadmap to navigate the uncertain territory. And unequivocally, in this, in many ways, end of the journey, we see that a critical value of the story is that it continues. So I like to imagine standing on that mountain aside Moses, getting a glimpse of all of these fantastic things that I imagine he has dreamed of year over year for what the end of the road may look like. And I imagine him having to offer it back to the God who got him that far. With gratitude that God was faithful to get him there through unimaginable circumstance, to then trust God, to let go. Trust that God is faithful to continue the story. A few weeks ago, I had the blessing and the uncertainty of my five-year-old returning to a classroom for kindergarten. And it's the first time she has been in-person learning since spring break of the last school year. As you can imagine, in our household where both Alyssa and I work full-time jobs, and both of our jobs, by and large, having to take place in our home, except for when I've been in here recording worship services once a week, having a five-year-old bounce around between us having to do school during that time has been, in some moments, interesting, certainly educational for us all, and very consuming of everyone's time and energy. This is a side note where I say a very important thank you to all of our educators and everyone in administration and schools working to make it safe and to make it a caring environment for children and educators to be in classrooms while also taking care of those who are still doing remote learning. So, I found myself able to re-engage some areas of ministry that I have not been able to give much attention to over the last several months. I found myself back in my office just down the hall here for the first time truly in months, aside from just a quick get my robe on and get my things printed to come preach a sermon. I had an interesting glimpse of the road that 2020 was supposed to be, friends. I felt like, in a metaphorical way, I had a nice 30,000-foot view of this terrain that seemed promised. I had physical calendars with dates marked on them and plans. Friends, you wouldn't believe what 2020 was going to look like in my world. It was going to be a great year. It's not to say we don't give thanks for what is, but man. The hypothetical 2020. The landscape of that terrain. To get a glimpse of it. And then, on the precipice of all that I could see, to take plan by plan and physically set it in the recycle bin. All of the hopes, all of the expectations, the road I have been journeying with this new church for the past, at that point in time, 6-7 months, now at this point in time, over a year. There were personal things like a 10-year anniversary vacation for Alyssa and I. Well, nope. Putting that in the trash bin. Birthday plans for not just me and my daughter and now Alyssa coming up and other family. I'm sure you have those things too. Yeah, we're all those plans we had, at the minimum, we're going to have to tweak them. At the most, all of those first drafts going into the trash bin. The visions for our ministries this year. The egg hunt we were going to have in Easter, man, it was going to be such a great outreach to our neighborhood. The partnerships that we were going to connect with for neighbors in need or other wonderful organizations doing so much good. One of our jokes for the staff has been, hey, remember Lent? All the plans we were going to have for our discipleship, for our worship, to see them physically written out in my office, and to say, well, I got to let go of that too. For all the emotions I imagine in Moses, I can at least tell you confessionally in this point, I was living a fair share of those emotions, friends. The longing, the nostalgia, the hope, a little bit of anger and sadness as well. And not a small amount of doubt to say, well, I don't even know now, God. But ultimately, I have to stand with it for what it is. Moses' story had reached its end for that chapter. Friends, my plans and my hopes for this year, I could clearly look around and see, well, that chapter is closed and it is time for the story to continue. And I've got to set it down, let it go, and say, God, you will be faithful to continue telling this story, yes? And that story is going to transcend all of my wonderful ideas, all of my wonderful thoughts and hopes, right? I can tell you, for the good of our church, friends, God has got to transcend all of the things that I may do as a pastor for better and worse. And so, we end up with a lot of things about what can be and what will be and how the story will continue. And it can be a bit messy trying to find a plan for worship that fits every need in our 600-ish member church family with a lot of different needs and a lot of different hopes and expectations. It can be a bit start and stop as we figure out what online church feels like, not just for a novelty for a few weeks, but as the way church happens. You know, friends, we were a physical church with a bit of an online presence. Now we're an online church with a bit of a physical presence. But also, I look and I see, well, the story isn't up to me. It is the work that the people will share together and create with God together. This story in Deuteronomy also looks to the people who will continue the story as well. Not just up to Moses, not just up to one leader like Joshua, but for the people to listen and respond and move in the way that God is calling them. Friends, you and I will have to listen and respond to the way that God is calling us. With the hopes that the work we begin now, even if we don't see it to fruition, even if it isn't the plan we thought when we started, that it will still be holy and good, and that those who join in the work will be also enlivened. Moses embodies for us that sense of planting a seed in a garden and cultivating it, knowing that he will not share the fruit of what becomes. But knowing that the investment he has made, the work he has made, the faith he has given enriches and enlivens and gives vitality to those who will follow. Now, I talked about my canceled plans and a canceled trip. I had to grieve that for a little while, friends, when it became clear that the 10-year anniversary trip Alyssa and I were going to take just wasn't going to happen this year. We have hope it's going to happen later. We have travel insurance and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, don't pity us too bad. We're going to be fine. But after a few weeks of feeling sorry for myself, I finally started feeling like maybe I could get curious about the broader world outside of my living room. And also, as I said, I had a 5-year-old running around in close quarters for several weeks. So I just needed some kind of escape. Because I'm a bit of a nerd, I started watching Rick Steves travel programs on PBS. I love it. He is a very soft-spoken man who knows so much and has traveled, especially over Europe. And I find it's a nice little window, even if it's just on my computer screen or on my TV screen, to see a bit more of the world outside of my front and backyard. And I was moved recently when I was watching one of his programs when they went to Barcelona, Spain. And one of the key features in Barcelona is this Basilica of the Sagrada Familia. It was started in 1882 by Antoni Gaudí. And he only got to work on it for a few years of his life in 1882. This behemoth of a structure of a cathedral that brought old and new styles of architecture together and just dominates the landscape in that city. By the time he died, it was just a tiny little entranceway and a skeleton of a building. Now, over 120 years later, the cathedral is not done. The work is not complete. They've had several new architects, several new creative teams come to work on that cathedral. And it is larger and more robust, more encompassing than anyone in 1882 would have ever imagined, but the work never stopped. You don't have to have a PhD in literature and metaphor to understand where we're connecting with this. Yes, friends. No matter what we hope, no matter what we plan, the work can continue. Because the story transcends our particular place in it, and the hope is that we invite others into the work. Whether it's planting seeds that we won't enjoy the fruit of, or if it's taking our turn putting a stone in the wall of the cathedral that others may worship in. The presence to it is holy. Not wishing away for some other future, not longing like Israel for some certain past, even with its pains and imperfections, but the holiness of this moment that God has given us and the deepest presence we can give to it. For all the flaws in the story of Moses and God's people moving from slavery to the promised land, I feel deeply confident that Moses was present to it. I wonder about, personally for each of us, for the rest of the couple months of 2020 and the uncertainty that lies ahead beyond that. Will you join me in trying to be present to it? I wonder about the ministries we share as a church family. The hopes and plans we have, maybe even the years of faithfulness that you have already invested on behalf of this church family. Next week, we will remember on All Saints those members of our church family who have died in the past year, and it may be hard for us to imagine a future without them. Can you imagine being in the crowd of the Israelites and getting the word that Moses had died? Even if you like Joshua, even if you trust Joshua, you gotta be thinking, They must have been wondering, how do we do this without Moses? And I know in our church family, there are people like that for us. How can we do this without those saints? What does it mean for us to look at this moment that we have and give God thanks for it and continue to be present to it? Knowing that even if we don't get to see the end result of where Plymouth Park United Methodist Church will be in 1 year, 5 years, 50 years, 100 years, even if we get just a glimpse of that glory, that we know that God keeps telling the story and God will keep drawing others in, that the love we share today is not just for our own transactional blessing, it is for God to share that love and transform and renew this world. And we get to participate in it now if we're awake to it. As we consider those things for our own plans for the coming months, if we consider those things for our ministries in the months and years to come, I am mindful of the words of the old rabbis. I have shared this quote before, friends, but I like to imagine these moments not just as standalone lessons that I give you, but conversations that we share as friends and family where we can pick up where we left off and it reminds us of other things. These words seem so true to me from the old rabbis. As we look at the uncertainty of the road ahead, as we try our best to trust God with what has gotten us to this place, that God will be faithful for what comes ahead. The old rabbis would say, do not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief. Do justly now. Love mercy now. Walk humbly now. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. May that be the sense of urgency with which we give ourselves to this moment and all of the hope and promise God has for us, that we might share that hope and promise with every breath, every step, every moment. Amen.
We respond to the word that we've heard. For friends, this is a conversation. This is engagement. This is interaction with a God that is sitting right here with us, a God that is present, a God that has gone before, behind, and beside us. And so we affirm our faith, and we hold the faith for those who are struggling and wrestling with God now. So will you join me in this affirmation? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Continues, and we plant those seeds and invest that work through our presence alongside one another. In some ways this week, that has looked like folks bringing clothes for warm in winter with our Many Helping Hands donation. There's an orange bucket outside of our office doors to continue those contributions for Many Helping Hands. It has looked like families saying, I want to be present to our neighborhood, and I'm going to have a trunk for trunk or treat for those kids to drive through and have some slice of fun in the season this year. For some folks, it is your continued financial generosity. Yes, to maintain worship like this on a weekly basis and to stay connected through study and through care and through service, but also knowing that it continues the ministry beyond this moment, that the love of God through this church might be extended beyond this moment as well. We're grateful for all the ways that you're present. It is the greatest commandment, friends. It's another way of saying it, how we love God with all of our being and love our neighbors as deeply. We give thanks for your presence to that work. Will you pray with me? God, all that we have and all that we are come from you. We ask that we could trust you, yes, with our financial gifts and resources, but truly, Lord, with our lives. That we could see this moment for all that it is and all that you may use us for. Not just to bless us in this story, Lord, but that we might participate in your blessing of all, in your transforming work that makes all things new, for your continued work that created everything and called it good, and your relentless commitment eternally to share your love and yourself in the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, and your abiding Holy Spirit to ensure that it will be good again and again through all of time. You are ours, and we are yours, so be it. Amen.
Thank you.
go from this time of worship together, I pray we feel the urgency of trusting God with where we are in this journey and feeling the urgency to do justice now, love mercy now, walk humbly now. Even if we don't complete it, even if we just get a glimpse of the glory, that is our work, not to abandon it, that others may join in the blessing of God's presence and love eternally. May we go forth with that urgency and that blessing from God who creates us, Christ who makes us whole, and the Holy Spirit who sustains us in this journey of life and faith together. Go in peace. Amen.